Welcome to this short talk about the minimum convex partition problem. So this is a joint work with Nicolas Catus, and we propose an integer programming formulation which is able to solve optimally problems or datasets of around 100 points. We also discuss a useful, I believe useful, geometric property for this problem. So let's start with the problem itself. As input, you are given a set of n points in the plane. And you can see an example here of 9 such points. And the question is to partition the convex hull of these points, which is denoted h of p here. And the question is to find a partition of the convex hull with a minimum number of convex polygons. You can see a solution here, and you can see the individual polygons that define this partition. And this is a solution of value 6. So the first thing to notice is that each of these polygons is actually convex. So typically, this would not be allowed. And the second thing is that no polygon contains a point of P in its interior. So typically, this would not be allowed. And finally, the polygons must define the partition of the convex hull. So the union of the polygons must be the convex hull, and the polygons must be pairwise disjoint, basically. So that's basically the definition of a partition. And so regarding these requirements, this is a valid solution of value 6. And it's not the best one. You have here a solution of value 5, so using only 5 polygons. Now the problem here has shown to be NP-hard by Nicolas Grolier in 2020. So that's a difficult problem. And to get a better understanding of it, we start by explaining a very simple algorithm to produce feasible solution. And when you have a data set, an easy way to produce a feasible solution is to take a triangulation, like this one. This will give you a valid partition. And from there, you can easily play with edges by removing or flipping or rotating edges. And typically, if you look at this solution, if you remove this edge, well, the face that remains is convex. So you are left with another feasible solution and with one face less. So you improve the objective value by 1 unit. And this technique of starting with a triangulation and playing with edges is at the core of many heuristic approaches designed by these authors here listed below. So let's have an example to clarify, and you can see a larger data set here and an initial triangulation of 187 faces. If you remove the useless edges, you quickly get to 76 faces. And if you apply the local search I was explaining, you will reach a solution of 63 faces, and you can see it running here. Now the optimal solution for this problem is 59. So this approach seems to produce good upper bounds, but how can we assert the quality of these upper bounds? So how can we design a lower bound? So that's what we do in this talk. So let's start with two remarks to design lower bound. The first one is that when you look at a solution, this is a planar graph, actually. The convex partition, the edges that define the partition, is a planar graph. So it satisfies what is called Euler's formula. And the number of vertices minus the number of edges plus the number of faces is equal to 2. And that shows that it's equivalent to minimize edges or faces, because both quantities are related by this equality. The second point is that you have a minimum degree for each vertex or each point. And this is due to the convexity constraint. Typically, when you consider a point P which is not on the same line than any two other points, so P is said to be in general position, well, P has a degree of at least 3 if you want to satisfy the convexity constraint. And the reason is, if you have only 2 edges, well, you are left on one side with an angle of more than 180 degrees. So this face would not be convex, typically. So the degree of P is at least 3. And when P is on the same line than 2 other points and in between, well, you can manage a degree of 2. So this gives you a lower bound on the degree. And if you plug it into Euler's formula, you have a lower bound on the number of edges. Hein? So you have a lower bound on the number of faces. And when you put the two things together. Going back at our example here, we had an upper bound on 63. The optimum solution is 59. And the lower bound produced by Euler's formula would be 50. So we are still left with a gap here. And by the way, for those who have worked on the benchmark, and this dataset is US Knight 100. Okay, so to produce better lower bounds, let's try to model the problem in linear integer linear programming. So a first way to do this model is to consider one variable for each edge, to define whether the edge is part of the planar graph or not. And this was done by Barbosa and all these authors in 2019. When you do that, you get a model that is able to solve optimally problems of around 40 points or 50 points and within a 20 minutes time limit. What we did here is that we, as opposed to edges, we considered faces. So one variable for each possible convex face. And before explaining the model, stating the model using this variable, I must explain or define the notion of right and left. So this is short and this is needed to understand the model. So let me go through it. When you have an edge ij, you can give it a direction from I to j. And once you have a direction, you have a natural left side and right side. And this can be defined using the cross product, for instance. And typically k is on the left side of ij, of arc ij, if the cross product of ij and ik is positive. So depending on the sign of the cross product, you will be on the left or the right. And this also allows to define a left and right side regarding faces. A face using arc ij or edge ij will be either to the left, like this one, or to the right, like this one. So you must keep in mind that we have this notion of right and left to understand the model. So keep that in mind and let's go through the model itself. The problem is seen now as like as a puzzle, as a tiling game. And you must tile the convex hull using the convex pieces that are allowed. The pieces allowed for this tiling are the convex faces. And you must use the minimum number of them. And so I recall we have one variable for each possible face. So the objective is easy to state. We are minimizing the number of faces. And the tiling constraints, the constraint enforcing a proper tiling, is what I call a face conservation along edges. So when you have a face on the left side of an edge, you must match it with a face on the other side, on the right side. When you look at the statement of the constraint for any edge ij, if you have a face on the left side of ij, meaning if this quantity is equal to 1, then you must cancel it out with a face on the right side of ij. So this is like a face conservation constraint along edges. Now this is true for the edges inside the hull. But when you consider edges on the hull, on the convex hull, then these edges will either produce or consume faces. So you will have a 1 or minus 1. And they act like sources or sinks of faces, typically. So this overall is like a tiling constraint, enforcing faces to match each other along edges. And that constraint alone is enough to define a valid formulation for this problem. Okay, even though it is valid, it's actually important to add the following constraint. And for any vertex I, we use the lower bound on the degree to enforce the minimum number of faces that are connected to I, which must be at least D of I that I already mentioned before. And this is important because it helps the linear relaxation actually. Okay, and recall we have one variable for each possible face. And so that's a bit tricky because big F here is a set of all possible convex faces. so that in the worst case, there is actually an exponential number of these faces. Now, despite that fact, we will see that this model actually scales very well, much better than the edge model. So we will see that at the end. Now, one question remains, though, is how to enumerate these faces to state this model. And for that, we actually use a simple and beautiful algorithm from the 90s, from this paper, searching for empty convex polygons, which enumerates chains in a so-called visibility graph and produce all possible convex faces. So it's not hard to do, and it's actually very fast. And it takes a few seconds. It's not the bottleneck of this model. So I am not going into details of how to do that. If you want to know, you can have a look at this paper. I will rather discuss a bit of geometry to improve this D of I, because this is a key point for the linear relaxation. So let me discuss a geometric property to finish. And this property is the following. Consider these points and consider any convex shape, and with a given boundary that I call C for convex here. And ask yourself the following question. What is the minimum number of edges that need to cross this boundary in any feasible solution, in any valid convex partition? Can we say something about that? If we can answer this question, I believe it is useful to improve the resolution of the problem and to improve our models. To do that, we consider the convex hull of the inner points of C. And these vertices have been called A, B, C, D, E here. And we try to establish a lower bound on the number of edges for each of these vertex. So if we start with B, you can notice the following. You can notice that the blue area here is actually empty of points. There are no points of P in this blue area. And if you maybe pause the video and look carefully, you can convince yourself that it means to maintain convexity that two edges will need to cross this boundary and connect to B. And if you don't have two edges, no matter what you do, you will be left with an angle of more than 180 degrees. And this is because this area is actually empty. So you can pause the video, check how this area is defined using the neighbors of B here in the convex hull, and try to see that for yourself. So we can continue this reasoning and look at C. C here, it's a different situation because there is at least one point in this blue area. And this means that we can manage convexity with a single additional edge here. D is similar to B, and we have a plus 2. And E and A here are different, they're on the convex hull, and we can have a plus 1. Basically, if you start reasoning like this, you can deduce that a minimum of 7 edges will need to cross the boundary C. Okay, this reasoning is actually useful in two specific cases that we use in our model. The first one is about the minimum degree of a point of the convex hull. If you consider this situation and you take this boundary C, well, you apply the reasoning and you get that P has a degree of minimum 4. It has two vertices of the convex hull and two edges from the convex hull and two additional edges from this reasoning. So this helps improving the redundant constraints I mentioned and improving the linear relaxation. Another consequence of this general property here is about mandatory faces. And if you consider again our running example and you use this boundary C, what you can observe here is that there is a minimum of two edges crossing the boundary here. But the only two points outside of C are these two points, meaning that this convex face is actually mandatory. It is part of any feasible solution. So that helps improving the formulation. And we have more properties in the paper if you want to have a look at it. In particular, we can show that some of the edges are actually dominated. And some of the edges, we can prove that some edges never take part of any optimal solution. And this is useful to reduce the number of constraints of the formulation. So have a look at the paper if you want to know more about this. Now it's time to conclude. So what we propose here is a very original and powerful IP formulation for this problem. It can solve in seconds data sets of around 50 points, data sets that would need 20 minutes in one here. It also solves optimally in minutes data sets of around 100 points, the largest data set proposed by Barbosa and all his co-authors. And it's also able to scale to much larger problem up to 300 points, and we can solve the linear relaxation for 300 points, which produce very good lower bound and very tight lower bounds. We also discuss a key geometric property, which is interesting to straighten the formulation and to pre-process it also. Now the two directions of research here is to use column generation or branch and price to handle this exponential number of variables. And this is not an uncommon situation in linear programming to have an exponential number of variables. And there are dedicated techniques to handle that, column generation and branch and price. But the more promising direction of research, in my opinion, is to actually take advantage of the geometric observations here to design cutting planes and to maybe improve even further these lower bounds. Thank you for your attention. I leave you with more detailed experimental results if you are interested in the problem. Have a good day.